I bet they're all around. Maybe not. Well, it doesn't matter.
I think we'll get you off sale. Anything else after this? Tell the lens away.
Sticky the debates and check the embed. Yeah.
Can you say something?
I will. And I'm about ready to put up the screen.
I
Granite Rock banner alive.
I'm not seeing the banner. I think that's more of the resolution of this.
Mr. Chair, what do you want?
Just go back on this one.
Oh, you guys are coming down?
Yes.
So it's three and something.
Something.
If you need to.
Okay.
Yes.
Yeah.
Hello, God. I get something, yes. But you guys are out of politics.
That's why I don't want to be sensitive.
It's not quite that.
Yes, God, right. They would see all the place. I don't. Relax. You didn't go out to me today, huh? You didn't go out to me today.
Sign. Yeah, we're in. Don't get credit from. Your head carrying the function.
Oh, okay.
It is coming.
Anything else I need to know about?
So, yeah, we want those two rights. We get the same.
B-A-T-E-S.
Hold on just a minute.
So there you go. Now it's sealed in his magic.
Professor, you have a question?
Yes.
David, what's your question? And these are the reasons why I'm saying, I just want to make sure.
Thank you.
Yes, if you're ready, I'm ready. The stuff's all lined up.
Okay. Hi, everybody. Thank you for coming. This is an important event because we've got Barbara, can you turn the mics up, please? So that people can hear us in here. So we have four people running for office. Three people running for office. We were all invited to be here tonight. I'm not sure why one of the persons didn't show up. We didn't confirm to be here. The other two informed me that they were going to be away. One had a prior commitment by working at a food pantry, and the other person is in Alaska. So, we're excited that we have five of the candidates here for you to listen to what they have to say, how they're going to serve Windham. And with that, I'd like to thank the candidates for being here. It's being broadcast live on Windham Cable TV, as well as in Granite Rock. Thank you, everyone who's involved with those productions. It takes a lot of time for people to be here and to make that service available to everybody. Specifically, Barbara Koch, Kelly Yucapiccio, Wally Heath, and two guys from Granite Rock, Steve Murphy, and Mike Rogers.
Point of order, sir. I hate to say it, but the mic's not on, and I don't know if this is being transmitted at home that with they could hear.
Well, let me check with Barbara.
Ken is coming across on the audio, so I think it will come through.
Is it?
Yeah.
Make sure each of you candidates have the mic close to you when you're speaking.
Okay. So with that, I'll turn it over to Representative David.
Thank you, Kenny. Tonight we're going to forego the opening statements that are typical in forums like this. We want to be able to maximize the time we have asking the candidates as many questions as possible to find their positions on a whole array of issues. The moderators for tonight will be the former school board member Ken Eyring and myself. I'm David Bates, one of the current state representatives who is not seeking re-election. As I mentioned, we'll be asking a wide variety of questions on important subject matters, many of which were taken up in this current session. Some were passed, some were not, likely to surface again, as well as some issues and questions that were sent to us through email by members of the public. And we're going to ask that the candidates answer questions in the order in which they're seated, which happens to be in the same order they will appear on the ballot. We're going to begin with the candidate closest to us, Representative McMahon, and each candidate will have 45 seconds to answer the questions. There's a timer staring right in front of the candidates, so they will know when their time is ticking down, and hopefully everybody will be careful to help us stay on track with the time constraints. And just so you know, that there's a monitor facing the audience as well, so they'll know if you go over. And when that ticks down to zero, there will be a very prominent stop message, and we would appreciate it if you would stop at that time. The moderators would have discretion, if necessary, to allot additional time for clarification or follow-up, if that's necessary. And at the end of the meeting, there will be a opportunity for a 90-second closing statement just to be able to maybe fill in anything that you weren't able to get in during the regular questions as we ask. So before we begin, I would ask that everybody would stand and join me with the Pledge of Allegiance. I pledge allegiance
to the flag of the United States of America and to the Republic for which it stands, one nation, under God,
support of the citizens of Windham to continue the work at the State House that I've been doing now for 16 years on their behalf. I am an aggressive advocate with manners, and I am a believer in getting things done while we're young, but doing it in a manner of cooperative collaboration to achieve consensus. And that's learning that you do not do it by yourself, you do it together. And I want to bring that type of experience and background and in providing constructive initiatives on behalf of the citizens of Windham and the state of New Hampshire to Concord. And with that in mind, I'm asking for your support based on my past record and in meeting the challenges that we're now facing going forward, opioid crisis among others. We need that type of leadership, and I'm looking to provide it. Thank you.
I've always been interested in politics, but never got very involved until the past couple of years. I noticed the state of America as a whole has been kind of becoming more of this divided state of us versus them. And I feel that there needs more representation of more of a younger generation who wants people to be friends with each other and realize that we are in fact neighbors and friends and love each other and not this us versus them conflict we have. So I'm hoping to run for politics and be elected to Concord to bring that younger, more let's get along mentality as opposed to what we have currently of the us versus them. That's all I have. Thank you.
Well, I'm running because I want to preserve the New Hampshire advantage. Philosopher Plato once said, and I'm going to paraphrase him, if you don't do politics, politics is going to do you in. And in my family, so my family's from Europe, Hungary, they escaped socialism. And they were done in by socialism, and I don't want that to happen here in America. Don't want it to happen to my family again. That's why I'm
here. So my name is Joel Desilay. I'm a strong conservative, very active in the Windham community, serving now my second term as selectman and my fifth year either as the selectman's primary or backup representative on the planning board in the Economic Development Committee. So I've been planning to do this for a long time. I'd love to serve Windham and Concord. I've had many families and business owners in the community encouraging me to keep serving and take it to the next level and represent Windham at the State House as your next state representative. I just released a list of in the Windham Independent out today of nearly 100 families and local business owners endorsing me. And I just want to take this opportunity to thank them for their continued trust and support.
Good evening. My name is Mary Griffin, and I'm seeking re-election because I think that I want to solve many more problems in which we have solved in the past. It's really amazing to be there. I've been there quite a while. But each year, we accomplish more and more for the good of the people. And that's how I feel. The good of the people is what interests me. I'm there to serve the people, and I'm there every time we need to be there. I'm 100% record of being in attendance. And I thank you very much, and I would like your vote tonight. Thank you.
Good evening, my name is Walter Colodgi. It's a tough question to without touting your own heart as to why you want to be up there. But I've been up there for 10 years on the Public Works and Highway Committee, and I think we've done a fine job improving the road structure in New Hampshire, maintaining the capital improvements program, the repair and replacement of the state's infrastructure. I moved to Windham about 30 odd years ago. And I started serving on the Windham Planning Board because I was irritated with some of the things that went on in the town. And I've always been an individual that, instead of complaining about it, go out there and do something about it. So I joined the Planning Board. And now I'm the state rep for the past 10 years. And I really appreciate the job. And I think we've done a good job there, all of us here who are your current state reps. And I seek your support. And I thank you for coming tonight.
Thank you. The next question is going to begin with Joseph. And it was clear from the questions submitted to us by people who emailed questions that the residents of the town are interested in what are you going to do for me now? They're concerned with local issues, the congestion in town, the availability of natural gas, water, and school funding, and a lot of things that affect local issues. And so the question is, what is it you hope, if elected, what do you hope to accomplish on behalf of Windham?
And could you specifically tell us if you have any ideas for bills that you would submit, or what issues you intend on championing for the people of Windham?
That's a very good and very complicated question. The two things that like I'm most concerned about are, I have two sons, age 1 and 4, about to enter the Windham school district here, and education is very important to me. I feel that in Kansas State is falling behind in education, especially compared to graduation rates and success stories of states like Massachusetts and New York. But to put a larger increase in both education and also in infrastructure, I'm an IT professional working for a global corporation now, actually transitioning to a new job soon, hopefully. And one thing I've noticed talking to companies like Amazon and Google is that they're not willing to come to New Hampshire because it's out of lack of industry. As you mentioned, the natural gas in New Hampshire is a lack of sewage. So increasing infrastructure would be very, very important as well to bring in new businesses. Thank you.
My approach to solving issues might be a little bit different. I'd like to get money back into people's pockets, lower taxes, and to deal with other issues, I think that we have technology, and we could use GoFundMe pages to raise funds for any projects that are needed. And that way, it's specific to what you need to get done. Say, I need to get this funded. Start a GoFundMe page, New Hampshire, this and this, fill in the blank, and do it that way. I think that would be a lot more effective in the modern age than just straight up taxation and okay, take them back there and putting it where the politician wants it instead of where the community wants it.
Cool. Thank you, Representative Bates. Probably like-minded to a number of the other candidates up here, I definitely want to maintain the New Hampshire advantage. There's constantly efforts to create broad-based taxes, state income taxes. Government likes to grow. And I'm a small government, constitutional conservative, so I will support efforts to lower taxes. I do not support any efforts to create or raise any taxes throughout the entire term on any bill. And I do believe there are ways to find cost savings in other areas, as opposed to raising or creating new taxes.
Thank you. I would like to see Windham stay as it is, a beautiful town. I'm interested in housing for the elderly as well as young people. There is a problem with living quarters for young people going to college. And there is a problem with elderly people who cannot afford to stay in their homes any longer. And I would like to keep our beautiful town the way it is and not grow too much. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Bates. One of the things that we're confronted with here is I think everybody goes down Route 111 trying to get out in the morning and trying to come home at night. It's become an horrendous of Route 111. And I have inserted in the 10-year bill a plan to do an engineering study from Wall Street down to beyond the transfer station, see if we can come up with a way that we can improve the road system, hopefully get it to be a two-way road both ways, because we're strangling ourselves with traffic right now. And with the upgrade of Route 93, it's not going to get any better. There's going to be an awful lot of development, economically and residential, and we have to improve the road system.
Thank you, Representative Bates. The historical perspective in the town of Windham is that we are the crossroads of Southern New Hampshire, and one of the issues that the town struggled with was the east-west corridor circumferential highway around Nashua. The big thing that played a role on that debate was issues that, sadly, we were not successful in advocating for enough, and as a result, we had the two lanes stopping in front of CVS, as we all know here, and a constant traffic jam on a daily basis taking place every day. This would be something on behalf of a New Hampshire Windham collaboration is to bring that back to the table in terms of funding, and that's working not to only with the state, but also the federal government because of the state highways.
Can I interrupt a moment here, please? When I said earlier, I got irritated at some things here in town. Challenges hit on us. When they were doing the circumferential highway coming across from 111, they wanted to expand it. We had something like 120 people who testified in town on that, and there was two people that spoke in favor of it. Charles McMahon and myself.
Before we move on to the next question, I just want to do a quick follow-up. Part of the question was asking, does anybody have a specific idea in mind for legislation to apply if you're elected to office? So nobody mentioned it. I'm just going to give you the second opportunity. If you have a bill in mind that you want to file, especially something that would be beneficial to the local interest in Windham, feel free to share that now. Does anybody want to?
If I may, Representative Bates, I'm working together with Madam Kosh, who's from the TV station here, and getting her guidance on an issue dealing with those who take care of their parents in their home or their adults in their home, and it's dealing with respite care. And we have an issue in our state that we've led the nation in home and community-based care, and in the town of Windham, there is a history of those who take care of themselves, but they do need help. And that help comes in the form of respite care or funding for it. That is a bill that I am working on right now and hope to present for the opening session.
Okay, thank you.
Yeah, I'd be interested in exploring the idea of actually having legislation that would say you should fund things through a GoFundMe system. That way, anything that they want to do would be a la carte. People would say, yes, this is good, we're going to fund that, we'll put money into it. It's amazing what people get funding for GoFundMe. Mm-hmm. It works.
Okay, thank you. Anybody else? Okay, and we'll move on to the next question, Ken.
Okay, this question's for Mr. Sodi. Would you support any legislation that would make purchasing, possessing, or using firearms more restrictive? So please elaborate.
Could you please say that again? It's not coming down.
Would you support any legislation that would make purchasing, possessing, or using firearms more restrictive? And if so, please elaborate.
I wouldn't restrict anything. It wouldn't make any difference making restrictions, because that only binds the good guy. Bad guys are going to get whatever they're going to get. One thing that on the federal level, maybe they should clean up the way the background checks and integrate things properly. Perhaps they should move to the private sector, get the NRA together with techies, and do background searches that way, where they don't miss things like the shooter, the atheist shooter who shot up the church in Texas, who shouldn't have had a firearm, but he did, and it was missed.
Thank you.
So, thank you, Representative Bates. So the short answer is no. No, I would not support more restrictive legislation that might infringe upon the Second Amendment. The slightly longer answer, since I have 32 seconds left.
You don't have to use it all.
Oh, and, but I will, in the utmost of honesty. So, of course, any bill that comes forward, and we are expecting that it could be something this next year that might come forward again. Any bill, I would certainly review. I'm certainly open to looking at research and data, but it has to be data-based. And another piece I would add is that I do intend to uphold the reciprocity that we have now for concealed carry.
Okay, thank you.
Mary?
Thank you. The question was?
Can I read the question?
Can we begin?
Yeah,
please.
I couldn't hear down here, so.
That's fine. Can you hear me now?
I can hear you now.
Okay. Would you support any legislation that would make purchasing, possessing, or using firearms more restrictive? And if so, please elaborate.
No, I don't think I would. I'm a firm believer in that guns need to be hidden away when they're not being used, and I don't believe that they should be carried around by anybody on their hip. I don't think that looks good. I think we're having all of those crimes across the country with people shooting others, but those are renegades. That's not the average person, so I would not say that. But what I'd like to see, I do support the NRA, and I think we are changing all the time for the better, and we're looking constantly into these things in Concord, and I do agree with that, so yes.
Thank you.
Thank you. No, I wouldn't. I've always been a strong supporter of the NRA, and I realize that we do have a problem with right now, there's a tremendous amount of shootings that are going on. I don't believe it's, well, I think that an awful lot of these people are mentally disturbed carrying out these shootings. And if there could be a better way to weed them out of the process of how they obtain a gun or whatnot, I don't know. It's a problem that the entire country has been struggling for many, many years, and right now, I don't see a solution for it. But no, I would not restrict any other things on the gun ownership.
Thank you. Charlie?
Representative Bates, thanks. My view is I am a supporter of the Second Amendment. That's been consistent since day one, being involved in the, both in town, by the way, as a past selectman, when those issues came up in discussions and also at the State House. The issue that I bring to the table on this is that if a citizen brought a issue to the table, though, they deserve a right to be heard and to have their proposal reviewed through respectful discourse. But it's based on a foundation of respecting the right to bear arms, the right to self-defense, and I have been consistent in that position and I have not changed.
As mentioned earlier, I have two children now who are going to move in the school district soon. So for me, concepts like school shootings are horrifying. I found myself researching concepts like bulletproof backpacks online to make sure my children are safe. I don't want to say I would advocate against any bills to restrict guns. I grew up hunting. I used to go deer hunting on John Hay Estate in New Hampshire. I'm a large fan of like hunting and self-defense, things like that. But I also balance that against things like child safety. Like if you want guns in your yard, but you think that a deaf child is an acceptable thing, I disagree with you on that one. I would not vote for anything unless it was, as my colleague said, data-based and fact-based, but I'm not going to buy myself in corner saying I will not support anything. Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you.
So, Mr. Bates? Just a real quick, I just wanted to color a little bit more when I said data-based. Really, one of the things that I would like to see and I would fight for in the data is data showing data collection and reporting showing how often in circumstances in which firearms are used to protect people, to save lives. You know, I think there's always a push on one side to kind of try to collate this data that shows that we have an issue. And I think to be really constructive, we need to have data showing, you know, how many women's lives in particular, and especially how many home burglaries are thwarted, et cetera, by firearms.
Okay, thank you. The next question is for you, school choice. Governor Sununu is a strong advocate for expanding choices in education. And one of his priority pieces of legislation this term was education savings accounts, which would give parents control over how some state education dollars are spent for their children's education. This bill fell short this term, but is very likely to be resubmitted next year. So will you support that? I'm beginning with Joel.
Thank you, Representative Bates. Yes, I will. I did also receive endorsement from School Choice for New Hampshire. This is an issue I care strongly about. I was homeschooled growing up, as well as going to a private school. So this issue definitely speaks to me. I know a lot of families in Windham participate and have their children in private schools as well as here in our great school systems. We also have some homeschoolers, so this issue does touch on Windham, and it's one I'm very passionate about. Thank you.
Mary?
Thank you. Yes, I do support the homeschooling, and I can tell you that there are people in town who homeschool their children who are setting such a fine example you couldn't believe. I would like to see more of that continue on, and hopefully I think the public will recognize someday that it is a necessity.
And beyond homeschooling, the question is specifically about the bill to authorize education savings accounts so that parents can have control over the money.
Absolutely.
Okay, thank you. Walter.
Thank you, Mr. Bates. I'm strongly in support of the bill the governor had out there, right? We're talking about hopefully passed, but we ran into resistance from the other side, the Democrats, unfortunately. But I think that an individual family should have the choice of whether they want to go to charter school, public school, private school, homeschooling, whatever. And if they do it, they save the towns an awful lot of money. But they should also be compensated for their efforts. And so the money should follow the student.
came in the evolution of meeting the unique challenges of our families with children that have sometimes educational challenges. Not just those who are much smarter, if you will, quicker in their lives, but also those with developmental disabilities. And in my 16 years at the State House, I have been one of the leaders at the State House in providing resources and access to services for parents who have distinct and unique challenges in providing educational opportunities for their children. And the earlier, the better is the mantra. So ESAs are something that I agree with. It does have an evolution that needs to respect how the funding takes place, and so I'll be supporting that work in the upcoming session.
Thank you.
Joseph? I'm a fan of ESAs, that's not really a topic. My one concern, though, is a lot of times when charter schools happen, a lot of funding is then taken away from other schools in towns, so my concern would be that making sure that Windham School District, as it is, does not lose a lot of money and all of our taxes go up. So I'm in support of it. I want to make sure that we have the control, and make sure that we didn't suffer as a result for those of us who want to have children in public schools, or those who didn't have children in schools at all. Thank you.
I'm all for school choice, and the fact that you can go beyond and say we should convert the whole system to charter school system. I was a probation officer, juvenile wages, and I saw how public schools failed. You'd have child study teams get together with 12 bobblehead social workers, when they only need one person to sit down with the kid teaching the read. It's inefficient. Charter schools, free competition, make things function more efficiently and be able to get the service properly done and for less cost.
Can I walk through about it? I graduated from an Andrew public school and I thought we'd be fine, personally.
Okay. I graduated from a public school too.
Yeah.
And it was a lot, it was very efficient. Thank you very much.
Okay, moving on to Joel.
Oh, I think I started that.
No, sorry. Oh, do we get to represent the Griffin now? So this is about school funding. Representative Bates filed legislation that led to the elimination of the cap on increases to education funding. And that resulted in our town receiving an additional $3 million per year, essentially doubling the amount of state aid that our town receives from $3 million to $6 million. A joint House and Senate study committee is currently meeting to consider possible changes to the adequacy aid formula again. So what and how will you protect Windham's interests regarding education funding? We started with Mary.
That's what she did. I can't hear down here, so I'm
not. Okay, so can you hear me?
Yes.
Okay. So Representative Bates filed legislation that eliminated this funding cap.
Yes, he did.
For education. So there's talk now with the committee to change the formula, which might be detrimental to our Windham education dollars. How will you protect Windham's interest in education funding moving forward?
How will I what?
Protect Windham's interest in education moving forward.
Well, I think Representative Bates had the right idea when he started, so whatever he said, I will follow. He's an expert in that, so I don't have to ask any questions.
Thank you.
Thank you. Well, it's a very delicate question up there because we have X amount of dollars to play with all the time, and the needs and the wants of the various agencies are overwhelming. You almost have to be like Solomon up there and figure out, what do? What do we give it to? And nobody is ever satisfied. Would I want to change the adequacy funding? No, I think at the present time, it's fine. I wouldn't support any efforts to reduce it. And if anything, maybe we could find some extra dollars up there that we could put some more funding into the schools.
Thank you.
Okay, thank you. The issue relative to funding is coming to a point of the ability to pay. And the debates that take place at the State House and in study committees or separate adjunct committees on these issues is finding ways to separate the haves versus the so-called have-nots. And what we had in a constitutional argument, and that Representative Bates was key in, was the Dover decision was having it constitutionally fair in the distribution of the statewide property tax. The way to maintain this, in my view, is to be ever vigilant and present at when these hearings come up, and then to let our town know as things progress, so that we have a verbal participation and an aggressive knowledge base as this law will evaluate how we move forward and how the final bill, if it comes, will be decided upon. So it's a big job to do.
Thank you. I'm not sure how to act at this moment. I think it's a subject that needs more study, more research into. I have a lot of friends that grew up in areas like Newport and Claremont, New Hampshire, where opioid crisis and murders are very high and have very low education funding. So every time you take money away from the school with another one, you have a detrimental effect to it. So I think we need to study more about how those effects and more money in certain towns have that. how they play out and what we should do for that. I'm a firm believer in keeping taxes lower, though, and not trying to just wastefully spend and get money to people that don't deserve it. But I wouldn't make a decision now unless there's more research done.
Thank you. I'm not too familiar with the legislation, but I know David and Bush and Andrew to get it right. And I know that you're not in trouble for it. So I vote for anything that you support.
Oh, thank you. Joel?
Thank you, Representative Bates. So firstly, this didn't happen easily, so thank you and the others involved for getting this done and for repairing kind of the deficit that Windham was experiencing. I agree with Representative McMahon on being diligent. That said, there could be some reasons to further adjust the formula, hopefully in Windham's favor. So I understand the diversity of incentives among other New Hampshire towns, but the reality is that some towns are growing like Windham, some towns aren't. And that's a product of decisions and hard work and dedication of dozens of people leading various towns throughout New Hampshire. Windham has been succeeding, and that doesn't mean we should be penalized in terms of our school funding. So I will diligently support maintaining our level of funding, if not increasing, but increasing the return of Windham taxpayer money that they deserve to get back.
Okay, thank you. The next question has to do with a law that was passed in May. And as a prelude to that, to the question, I just point out that most parents would agree that they know what is best for their children. But a law was passed this session that made a ban on therapy for children with gender identity disorder. This law limits professional therapists from counseling transgender patients so that they can only facilitate children changing their gender identity. But it prohibits the same therapist from helping a child with gender identity disorder to be accepting and comfortable with their biological sex. Do you agree with this new law, which prevents parents from seeking the type of professional help from therapists that they feel is best for their child?
That question to
begin
me?
With Walter.
That question to me?
Starting with Walter.
That's a very nice question. Thank you very much.
We have so much difficulty hearing you now.
Yeah, really.
The table.
I should have been down there where I could do it.
What a question to shout out, man. It's a very, very difficult question. I think that a parent should have the ability to do whatever they so desire to do for the betterment of their child. It's the transgender, homosexuality is a very difficult thing for any parent to confront. I have a daughter who is a gay daughter, and she basically broke my heart when she came up. I had so many dreams for her and my grandchildren and all that stuff. But you know what? I didn't abandon her. Just this past week, I was in New York, took her out to dinner, and we had a great time. And it's a difficult thing for me to accept. But an awful lot of, I shouldn't say an awful lot, I think about 98% of the people that I meet when I go down there and we go out and have a good old time, is they're the alternate persuasion. We all get along together. We have
wrap it up, that do you agree with the law that has been put in effect?
I don't think that any parent should be prohibited from doing what they think is in the best interest of their child.
Okay, thank you. Charlie?
That particular issue was heard in my committee, Health and Human Services and Elderly Affairs. And the testimony there was not only from parents, but also very strong church groups as well, being allowed to continue the right and the choice to respond to when families are looking for assistance and for help. And specifically with parents, I am a supporter, believer, and will continue to be that parents have the jurisdictional authority in raising their children and should be made aware of when their child is facing a challenge of any kind. There are some school districts right now that direct not to tell the parents if there's an issue relative to transgender question. I don't support that, and I'm not in support of that effort.
Okay, just to clarify, again, the question is, do you agree with them that in your case, it's kind of almost a silly question, because I believe you were a sponsor on this legislation, but it's become law now. So the question, just to reiterate for everyone, is do you agree with this law that has been passed, which limits a parent's ability to seek the kind of counseling they feel is appropriate for their child, a child that has gender identity disorder? Because now, with this new law in effect, it is illegal for a therapist to counsel a child in that situation to be accepting of their biological sex. They can only counsel them in the direction of transitioning to the opposite sex.
And the thing to clarify, Representative Bates, that's a separate law. You had the transgender rights issue for anti-discrimination. That was one that I joined with because I will always fight against discrimination, and that was one of the issues that came with dramatic testimony in our committee. Separate law. What you're talking about is one issue I did not support. And
okay.
That issue was...
I apologize.
But it's a very difficult project when you're dealing with a reality of what someone believes they are, could be, might be, should be, and then how do you help if they need it, want it, or need to have it? And the parents play a major role, 18 and under, I might add. So that was a debate, and going forward, if it comes up, please come to these hearings. You can really make a difference, and that's why some of these things move forward or not.
Okay.
But please understand, I could not support that at all. Parents rule the day for you.
Joseph?
I agree with everything you said. I believe discrimination is a big issue. We need to take steps to avoid it. And I also, I don't use it, but I have a degree in psychology back in college, long story. But I do believe that restricting access to mental health is a big issue, and we should never restrict a parent's choice or a child's choice to get the counseling and the help they need. If you go to someone and they tell you this is the only path, that's a problem. If you go to a counselor or a therapist or a psychologist, a psychiatrist, they should be able to tell you these are your options. What do you need help with? How can I help you? Not this is your one path. Thank you.
Yeah, I wouldn't support a bill that says kid go in one direction. In fact, before kids 18, their hormones are changing. They might change their mind three or four times by the time everything is said and done. So I think parents definitely should have the freedom to choose what they're doing with their kid.
Joel? Thank you, Representative Bates. I haven't carefully reviewed the law that passed, in all honesty, so I would have to fully review it. On its surface, I do not support the law. I believe parents should be able to choose what's best for their children, period. And I believe on any and all issues, this just being one of many of them, there has to be 100% transparency with parents. That's critical to me, as early in the process as possible. On every single issue, where it's a concept of government or a school, keeping information from the parent. I do believe parents will choose what's best for their children. And either way, they should have the opportunity to do so. Ultimately, laws might allow a child in some circumstances to still make some choices through a school or what have you. But I stand with the parent as early in the process as possible, 100% transparency always.
Thank you, Mr. Bates. I believe that the parent should have full responsibility. They know their children, they know what they need, and no one else should be interfering in that.
Okay, thank you. Okay, thank you. So some of these questions
effort to, you know, sometimes we've got people who are on one side of an issue or another, and it gets kind of adversarial. And, you know, this is a difficult question, but it's important for people to know how you stand on certain issues. There was an anti-discrimination law that was passed that provided special anti-discrimination protections for transgender men and women. And the bill provides access to bathrooms and locker rooms for the opposite sex, as well as scholarship opportunities. And we'd like to know if you support this law. And part of the background on that is that we have discrimination that occurs every day. In Oakland, a coffee shop refused to serve a police officer, saying that they have a policy asking police to leave for the physical and emotional safety of their customers and ourselves. And just in the town next door, in Derry, in February, they announced, there's a computer store who announced that they won't, that they're going to discriminate against Republicans, saying that they're not welcome and none will be served. So where do you draw the line on discrimination? Do you support an anti-discrimination law for transgender individuals? And I believe we start with Charlie.
Okay.
Oh, you got it, Charlie.
All right, thank you very much. I do support that issue of the transgender challenge that we face at the State House today. And the issue is to make it absolutely clear what's in the law, though, and what was added to our anti-discrimination law was to prevent discrimination for jobs, housing, and access to public spaces. That was it. That's in black letter law now. An additional definition was added, which was transgender. Going forward, the rules that are made, just like our school board made this year, is how do they apply those in their specific space? That is handled at that level, not at the state level. So rules still play the role, and you still participate. But in terms of discrimination, I reject that notion. There's a lot of historical fact we can go through. This is not the time for it. For any type of group, religious, ethnic, and otherwise, I will not be one that will join with those who will single out others because they don't like them. We will protect everyone, which is all of us individually. Thank you.
Okay, thank you. I was agreeing with you more and more as we talk here. I'm firmly anti-discrimination. Big concern I've noticed with my issue especially is how do you define transgender? I mean, can a person like me decide I'm a woman today just go to the locker room and spy on people and then the next day be a man, or does it have to be something where you seek therapy? I believe if you're actually on a transgender path, that's a clear definition, then yes, you should not be discriminated upon. I also believe that private organizations and private companies should have a little more control over what they're doing. No one should be forced to do things that make them feel uncomfortable, regardless of who you are or what you believe in.
I think we already have a lot of enough anti-discrimination laws already on the books. We're either now all equal and have equal rights, or what do you have, special rights for different categories? You make up, how many different categories do we make up? We make up, okay, nearsighted people. I might have to have 6-foot letters on your signs because we don't want to wear our glasses. I'm not into the special rights.
Thank you, Representative Bates. I would have, my apology, could you clarify, what was the exact question? It's been, I've forgotten, down the line.
Well,
you are, what was your question?
Yeah, HB 1319 is an anti-discrimination law, and discrimination happens every day to different groups of people. I cited two of them, police officers in California, and apparently Republicans in the state of New Hampshire when it comes to a computer store in Derry. And my question was, do you support the law, which provides access to bathrooms, locker rooms of the opposite sex, as well as scholarship opportunities to transgender individuals?
Just to be clear, it was an amendment to the Human Rights Commission
expanded additional class of people who identify as transgender. So the law prohibits discrimination on the basis of gender identity.
Okay, thank you. My apologies. Yes, so as should be evident, I have not reviewed that law or the amendment. I would have to do that, as with any change to a law, as a strong fiscal conservative, I would always have to look at the cost. What's the cost to local business owners? It's not all about the money, but that is a piece of the equation. The cost would need to be as fully understood as possible prior to supporting anything like this. The short answer is everybody should be protected, but I also support small government. So at what point do our existing laws already work? At what point do we need to improve things? I'm certainly open to reviewing that, but harassment discrimination is already illegal. I have to take a closer look at this law to completely answer my question.
Okay.
Thank you. It's very easy for me because I don't believe in discrimination of any kind.
Okay. Thank you very much. Okay, moving on now, we need to...
Oh, I'm sorry. Yes, I did.
I just threw a passage on my. Boy, the times they are changing. And it's a very difficult thing because everybody, an awful lot of people on the alternate lifestyle, they believe that they were discriminated against here and there. Back in my day growing up, it wasn't even talked about. But we're into a different society nowadays, and the people of today's society are much more accepting than we were in the past. And as I told the group that we went to a couple of transgender meetings here in town, that it's a hard issue today. A lot of kids don't like to see their, a lot of parents don't like to see their children having the opposite sex come into the locker room or into the bathroom and stuff of that nature right there, and I agree with them there. But as I also said, 10, 15 years from today, it won't even be a question on the agenda. It'll be totally accepted. That's the way the generation and society is moving.
Okay, thank you. Okay, moving on, beginning with Representative McMahon. Oh, you should. You start off with, who started the last one? You started with each other, right?
Okay. Whatever you feel is appropriate.
No, we'll keep the rotation going. So I'm sorry, Joseph, you'll be answering. You'll be starting.
Sure.
If it's an easy one, I'll
start. So New Hampshire is the only state in our nation that allows non-residents to vote in its elections. Do you believe New Hampshire election laws related to voting are too restrictive, too permissive, or appropriate as they currently are? And if you think that, you can explain unless you just think they're appropriate as they are. Go ahead.
Kind of a combination of the first two. I have a lot of friends who are recently graduating from college or still in college, younger siblings, friends I know and whatnot. I'm not a huge fan of college students going into New Hampshire voting, so people coming in from other states making choices in elections, then leave immediately. However, the current legislation being sponsored, that requires you to have a driver's license or to register a car after means you have to pay a tax to vote. And I'm kind of torn. I don't think non-residents should vote, but I also think don't think you should, you have to pay money to vote. I'm kind of on that balance in the middle. So it's simultaneously too restrictive and too loose based on which specific aspects you're looking at.
So I'll try to refrain from entering the debate. But that was my bill that became what I made reference to. And it does not impose any kind of fee or tax on people registering to vote. It didn't change any requirements for voting whatsoever.
My comments, the last thing I read, which may be incorrect, was if you were domiciled here after you then had to either register a car or get a driver's license. Then there were people that didn't have a car, didn't want either one to work here. That was my one concern.
Right, so if the person doesn't have a charter, they don't have to register.
Oh, then we lost my everything.
Julius.
Your address isn't here, it's not where you're listed, you shouldn't be voting here.
Thank you.
So, thank you, Representative Bates. Certainly as a selectman, we work at the polls each year. Voter integrity is extremely important. I believe that the existing laws, including the new law that's passed, is appropriate as is. I do think that the conversation, both in New Hampshire as well as nationally, should continue, because I think when a student first goes to a college, that's also the first time they're voting. So I think there should be potentially more education to help help someone choose, and also at a time when we want to move, we've got gentrification in the state, which is actually a positive thing. It says a lot of people like to live here and stay here, but we also want younger people to choose to stay and work here as well. So what better way than to encourage a college student to come here and actually move here and live and start their family in New Hampshire? So I think we need to balance those, and we should start continuing the conversation.
Okay. Mary, just to reiterate the question for you, do you believe that New Hampshire election laws are too restrictive, too permissive, or just about right the way they are?
Well, I don't think they're too restrictive. Serving on the supervisor of the checklist, there are so many, I did not realize this before until this year, but there are so many errors. You have to be very strict with this, and I did not believe that before, and I didn't know anything about it, but after being on the board, I can tell you there are many, many errors, and it needs to be corrected, which we are doing. But I think we need to have strict laws about that, because we've seen people sneaking in when they shouldn't be, so.
Thank you.
Thank you.
I believe that if you live in the state, you're a resident of the state, you vote in the state. When I was in the military, if I wanted to vote, I had to get an absentee ballot. I couldn't go into town. And they say there wasn't a lot of voter fraud in this state because the domicile rules and everything else. I could bring all my brothers up, put them in my house the night before the election. They get out in the morning and they say, "Where your domicile?" "Hey, Kent Street." "Oh, they give them an absentee ballot." And they're supposed to say, "Well, I'm going to stay in the state." Well, they vote, they walk out the front door and they say, "Oh, well, I changed my mind." Perfectly legal. That's why we did the bill, to make sure that if you're a resident of the state, you vote in the state, and if you're not, you're a college student or whatever, you want to register your card, become a resident of the state, all well and good. If not, get an absentee ballot and vote in the state where you reside.
Thank you.
I believe the existing, but the changes that Representative Bates championed has improved that environment to qualify those who choose to vote. Not everyone does, and in the town of Windham, we've seen that a lot. The participation is hopefully going to be greater this year. And the point to do, as Representative Griffin indicated, is to confirm, ratify, and ensure that those who are ready to vote have met the criteria for qualification. And that takes work, and the committee that we have to do that is very important in our town for the integrity of our voting list. So what we have at the state level, enabling legislation carried out by the local cities and towns, I believe should be allowed to move forward. And for any improvements, let's see how this works with this new law, and then if any changes, to respond with the guidance from our respective cities and towns.
Okay, thank you. So the next question is regarding a bill that was voted on this year. It's HB 628, Family Medical Leave Insurance. This was a bill to create a state program to provide family and medical leave insurance, but only for private sector employees. Even though this type of insurance is already available in the state, the original bill proposed to create a state program to be funded by payroll deductions, which effectively would be the first direct tax on income in New Hampshire. If this or a similar bill is introduced again next year, will you support it? And the question goes to Mr. Sutherland.
No, I would not support that bill. It sets us on a slippery slope down the income tax road. I don't think we need to mess around with people's choices and how they deal with their money. You set up something like this, the government's supposed to fund it. The only way they're going to fund it is with taxes. It's never going to balance, because the government doesn't take your money, you invest it somewhere. You make money with your money that way, and you provide for yourself and your family. What we need is people need to be more financially educated.
Representative Bates, as you mentioned, insurance is already available for this purpose in the private sector. So to create a payroll deduction tax, I do agree this would essentially equate to a state income tax in New Hampshire. I will not support an income tax in New Hampshire. This is a large part of our New Hampshire advantage, and I will never support that. As well, through my participation in private sector organizations where I work, and from what I read, I understand in the free market, companies can offer things to their employees. That could, in fact, in many cases, give them advantages. I actually think of, as a company, electing to do something like this, as well as electing for, from what I read most recently, one of the most distinguishing things a corporation can elect to do is to refund money towards education. This could be another area in that can happen in the market as things are right now.
Thank you.
All right.
Thank you. Eventually, this would have equated with an income tax. It sounded good in the beginning, but needed a lot of work. And after thorough review, it was turned down. And I think that was the best way it should have gone.
Okay, thank you. Walter.
I am not in support of any income tax or any tax whatsoever that doesn't have a stated purpose of for the betterment of all employees.
Thank you.
Very briefly, I was a co-sponsor of House Bill 628, and as one who believes in empowering families that take self-responsibility, self-reliance, and self-respect in taking care of their elderly and also their family members with severe medical conditions in their homes, the Family Medical Leave Act was giving that option. The disingenuous spin that it was an income tax is fundamentally false. This was a choice to be made to employers, given the choice to a employee if they wanted to participate in this. The amount of economic review needs to be done further and to provide that benefit to our citizens in New Hampshire. The home and community-based care in New Hampshire leads the nation in it. This was allowing people to take care of their family members in their home. We have an opportunity to continue this discussion and to have it cost effective, but it is not an income tax, and it's not a pervasive tax on individuals without their own visit with by government largesse. That is a false statement.
I'll have to express a different opinion with you, respectfully, Charlie. I've got the bill and the original text. I have it here in front of me, and the cost to operate, this is a financial note, and the analysis done by people up at the state level said that the cost of the bill to operate the program were unknown. They estimated at least $10 million over the first 4 years to get it going. And the insurance department stated that the insurance plans were currently in existence that would provide coverage for these types of benefits. There was a 0.5% tax on people's income in order to fund it. And once people were enrolled in it, in the bill, the original tax, they could never get out. And that was modified down the road, but people were concerned because it was kind of like Hotel California. You know, you can check in, but you can't leave. And those were the concerns I heard from many people. And there were a lot of issues with this, and we've tried this in other states, and the costs are much higher than what the funding would have been with the tax that would have put on people's income, because it was a tax on somebody's income. And the other issue is that it was only on people in the private sector, not in the public sector. So there were some issues here that clearly have to be addressed. I just want to share those thoughts. Because I challenged what you said, I'd like to give you a few seconds to respond to that, just to be fair to you.
Well, I appreciate that fairness, because I was going to do it in any case. The fact is that you want to debate and that come fully armed intellectually. The fact that we have here is that
Mr.
we have...
Man, please be respectful.
Oh, I'm respectful, Ken. You know that.
Not when you question my intellect.
I didn't question your intellect.
You
I'm just talking about...
You prepared intellectually, sir.
Let's just stipulate that wasn't the case. The issue here that we've had on this is a product cost. And in this product cost, it's being part of a large group, and anyone who's bought health insurance in the past, the smaller the group, the bigger the cost, and vice versa. That's what this was targeting. Now, in terms of participation, it does require participation. That's how it would need to work. And that's what it was going through in this process. And the different actuarial projections is what the debating point is, in all respect to my friend Ken. And that being said, more work needs to be done to provide this opportunity for a cost-effective insurance plan that can be purchased by choice. And that, I'm hoping, would come back again for the due process and for review to make sure that he hits all the benefits that we want to do. And you don't have to be in a quote, it's up to a company still to decide whether to participate or not. They're not mandated. And that wasn't the proposal in that in 628. But that's part of being great about being a rep. You're part of these things that can really help and benefit everyone in the state of New Hampshire, but be a part of the process. And it's a lot of work and a commitment. And you work together collaboratively. And even if you have a disagreement, maybe we come to a collaboration and move forward to help our fellow citizens. That's the ultimate goal.
And Joe? I've actually taken use of the Federal Medical Leave Act twice in the past 5 years. I have two children, both my wife and I took extended time away from to raise our children and care for them when they were first born. We both work in Massachusetts, and both of our corporations allowed us a lot more leave. My wife was actually allowed 16 weeks of full pay, now it's allowed 12, which made a big difference. I'm a big fan of that. I have a lot of friends and family members who are teachers who are very concerned if they get pregnant during the school year. Yeah, their job is guaranteed for a while, but they might not be able to afford to live. And how do you tell someone, hey, you had a kid, now you can't afford to eat meat? On the other side, I'm also adamantly against the income tax. I'm sure the income tax is actually safer to never be increased in the state. So I think it needs to be balanced, but I am in favor of supplying at least some support.
Create a state program, not a private insurance company, which is, we're in Massachusetts. So this is about to New Hampshire create a state program that would create a family medical leave insurance program and fund it with taxation on income.
Well, that my answer, it depends. I'm in favor of the act. I'm very concerned about the funding mechanism.
Okay, the next question, I believe we're going to begin with Joel. You were correct?
Yep.
This has to do with abortion. And we frame this question to, in the parlance of the two very polarized sides, to mask my lack of objectivity. So, do you support an unborn child's right to life, or a woman's right to choose to end that life? Beginning with Joel.
Thank you, Mr. Representative. I support, I'm pro-life, so I support the child's right to live. And I did also receive an A rating from the New Hampshire Right to Life organization. This is an issue that's very important to me, and I do realize there are different people with different opinions, and that's fine. My opinion is I am pro-life. That is religious-based. And I am Christian.
Thank you.
Mary. Doesn't work.
Thank you very much. I am pro-life, I have to say that. But there are certain cases where those things happen, and I think that's up to the person who is involved in it as well as a physician. There are a lot of things that we don't know that happen to people in their lives, and so I try to stay out of other people's business, but basically I'm pro-life.
Thank you, Walter.
Thank you, David. I am pro-life. I'm a man, so I really don't have much to say about it, but I will echo the words of soon to be the Justice Kavanaugh. It's settled law. And whether I agree with it or not, it's the law. I can't choose which laws I wish to obey, which I do not obey. So if the current law is that the woman has the right get an abortion. I don't agree with it, but that's what the law is.
punch list on having the answers for a woman on all those matters with one basic statement. I do, though, believe that you work, like I've said already multiple times, it's working together. The mail does play a role in how the fetus became viable, and we need to work together on that collaboratively and have the right choices.
Guys aren't really punches tonight, huh? I asked my wife, my sister, and my mother this exact question yesterday to get their opinions on it, and they told me that they're all for choice. My concern is that there needs to be a line drawn. If I had to choose, I'd probably say I'm more choice than pro-life, especially in instances like incest and rape and things like that. I believe if you're raped, you should not be forced to carry someone's child and pay child support. That said, there needs to be lines drawn in the sand. You can't just be murdering children. As everyone else, or most people said, I'm a man. I can't have a child. I have two. I love them. I have concerns if someone doesn't want a child and force them to bring it into this world. Is that child going to get the love and respect they need? But it's not an easy question for you to answer.
Well, I agree. It's not an easy question, but I can assure you it comes up virtually every year in the legislature in one form or another. So that's why we're asking.
Given the option, I'd say 55% pro-choice, 45% pro-life. I'm just on that other side of the line a little bit.
Okay.
That's
Julius.
Okay, metaphysical question here. First, let me say that I've never voted to government funding for abortion. Never. Next question is, when is human life a human life? There's some debate on that, even amongst religions. I, for one, am saying that I'm asking how much time do you need to take a given abortion? The more time you waste, the worse it gets. How many cells constitute a human being? Is it the original cell? I would leave that choice to the woman. But there is a certain point where you gotta say, no, you can't waste any more time. No, you're done. If you have a late-term abortion, that's sick. That's like, that's absolutely selfish. At that point, if it's a, it's almost viable. You have to get up for adoption.
Thank you. All right, so,
Representative?
Yes.
Yeah, if I could, just hearing some of the other answers, I just want to make sure my position was 100% clear, because there's sometimes nuances come up in conversations. So in all circumstances, I am 100% pro-life.
Thank you, Thomas.
So now, thank you. Those were some difficult questions, and really appreciate everybody providing thoughtful answers.
Now we'll get to the hard ones.
No,
actually,
just one more question.
Representative Clodge, you have a question?
Well, most of all the questions go around heading towards Charlie to Health and Human Services, but generally out there for
the highway.
Highway and
So we're going to do what's called lightning round questions. So these questions are intended to be yes or no answers.
You do not have 45 seconds.
No.
You want to move through these very quickly.
The intent is to ask the question, and we're still continuing with the rotation. But the intent is to just answer yes or no and go through as quickly as we can. We're hoping to do a question every 30 seconds to see if you can.
Again, I would ask you, Kevin, could you please up the level?
All right, so here's the question. Can you hear me? All right, so will you take, if you haven't already, please let us know if you have, will you take the CNHT taxpayers' pledge and pledge to vote against any increases for tax? For any taxes, or new taxes, or existing taxes, would you vote to raise any existing taxes?
You mix it up. The question is, will you take the pledge not to raise any new taxes?
Isn't that the Thompson Pledge?
Yes.
There's various groups that have pledges. The essence is, irrespective of what group, has solicited people signing their pledges, can you pledge here tonight to the people you want to represent, the residents of Windham, that you will
support any new taxes in the state legislature.
You were asking me?
Yes, we're beginning with you.
You should know my answer.
I know, but you're gonna do it for the rest.
Well, thanks.
What was your answer?
Yes.
What was it?
I've always stayed in the election.
And I have too.
Yes.
No. I believe in being fiscally responsive, or fiscally responsible, but if there's a trade-off for a new tax or an old one, I would just consider it based on what we need.
Here it is, signed.
My answer is yes, I've also taken the pledge and I have been endorsed by the New Hampshire Conservative Majority Party as well.
Thank you. The next question is, would you support a ban on partial birth abortion? And I believe we're beginning with Walter on this one.
Always have.
Yes.
Can you find out a little more? I'm not sure what that is, partial birth abortion.
Do you want to find it? I was asking you, partial birth abortion is a very late term abortion where the child is virtually at the point of being birthed, at the point where the child begins to exit the birth canal, its life is terminated by inserting scissors into the head or back of the neck.
No, I'm not for that.
Right.
I would not support any kind of abortion, late term abortion whatsoever.
I think the question is, do we support the ban?
Would you support a ban? Yes.
Okay. So okay, so my answer is yes as well. And I think I answered it pretty clearly on the other question, 100% on both.
Okay.
My answer is yes.
Thank you.
Okay. Would, Dave, we start with Walter on this one. Would you support legislation that requires healthcare providers to provide data regarding abortions?
Here we go.
Yes or no?
I'd say yes.
What's the question?
Would you support that?
If it's confidential, yes.
Okay.
Depend on factors, but yes.
Can you repeat the question?
Yes.
Would you support legislation that requires healthcare providers to provide data regarding abortions?
People should be informed.
Anonymized data, I assume, and yes.
Yes.
Okay, thank you. Would you, beginning with Charlie, would you support legislation that would repeal the buffer zone law?
Is that reference to voting?
No.
That's correct.
This is a protest.
This has to do with people's right to protest at abortion clinics. We have a law on the books that does prohibit that, and there was a court case that ruled it unconstitutional, but it's still on our books. So would you support repealing that law?
Yes.
Probably yes. Interesting question, because the Supreme Court also is buffed along, but they rule against them all the time. As long as you're not interfering with someone, your right to be heard should be maintained. So yes.
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 Unconstitutional, of course.
Okay. This one goes to Joe. Would you oppose frivolous spending measures even if supported by party leadership?
It would depend on if the Windham president supported it, but in general, yes, I oppose frivolous spending.
I oppose all kinds of frivolous spending. Yes.
No.
Just say yes.
Okay, just say yes. I'll say yes. I didn't hear
it. It's okay to ask to repeat the question.
You need to speak loudly. And David, you can do that at the house, so you can do it here.
Ken asked the question.
Well, Ken, you need to learn how to do that.
I'll work on it.
Okay.
Would you oppose frivolous spending measures even if supported by party leadership?
Would I oppose frivolous spending?
Yes, even if supported by party leadership.
Oppose.
Supported by party leadership.
Yes. Okay. I've done that.
I know that.
I'll support my esteemed friend here.
Thank you.
Yes, sir.
Next question. Should taxpayers bear the burden of giving any government benefits to illegal immigrants?
Did you forget that?
We're starting with Joe. Oh, I'm sorry. Julius, go ahead.
Absolutely not.
No.
No.
Definitely not.
No.
No.
Okay. Okay, would you, this goes for Joel. Would you support a law that would prevent New Hampshire towns and cities to declare themselves to be sanctuary cities and/or towns?
Just to clarify, did you say a law that would prevent cities
yes.
from creating their own law?
Correct. Would you support a law that would prevent New Hampshire towns and cities to declare themselves to be sanctuary cities?
Yes.
I'm trying to get the end of the question.
Do you support sanctuary cities?
Oh, no.
Okay.
Right out, no.
So you would support a law that would prohibit sanctuary cities?
Yes.
Okay.
Yes.
Yes.
No, I believe towns have the right to choose themselves.
I say yes as well.
Okay. If another vote comes up to reauthorize Medicaid expansion, will you vote to support that? And we're beginning Mary. Reauthorizing Medicaid expansion.
Well, I think medication expansion could possibly be worked out in the future. It could be a long time into the future. But right now, I have to say no.
No.
No. Depends on funding, but yes.
No.
No.
Okay. All right, so this is related to pensions for public workers. Should each locality be responsible for its own employee retirement obligations rather than being managed through the state? So in other words, should each town have to pay the retirement obligations of its employees? Or should that go through the state?
I would like to say yes, because I am fully aware of the fact that in New Hampshire we're $6.4 billion unfunded liabilities to our pension system. That averages up to a little over $5,000 per person.
All right, just the yes or no, please.
Thank you.
I understand. Yes.
Yes.
Yes. Yes, it's for the town.
Yes.
Yes, and that's something we're already doing right here.
Yes.
Okay. Should local towns or cities in New Hampshire be permitted to set their own rules for where law-abiding citizens may legally carry a firearm? And we're starting Charlie.
Yes.
It depends, but yes.
No.
No. No.
No, you have to have uniformity throughout the state.
Okay. Thank you. So now we're going to continue with some questions that we'll be able to respond to very briefly. We're almost done. And up until now, all of the questions have been somewhat theoretical. But for those of us still in the legislature, we will be gathering next Thursday for a veto session, potentially voting on 6 veto overrides. And so, for those of us who are in the legislature and those of you who would like to be, we're going to ask you how you would vote on these bills that the governor has vetoed. I will give you a very quick explanation of what the bill is, a snippet of why the governor, from the veto message, why the governor vetoed it, and ask if you will vote for those of us who will be voting and those who are seeking the office, how would you vote on these veto overrides? Would you vote to sustain the governor's veto, or would you vote to override it? So the first question really doesn't even require any explanation. It is a bill, a Senate bill number 593 to repeal the death penalty. So beginning with Charlie. I believe we'll start with Charlie because I have trouble remembering. Would you vote to override the governor's veto and repeal the death penalty? governor vetoed it. Next week, we're going to be called upon to vote whether or not to override that veto. So would you support the governor's veto or vote to override it?
I'm not sure. I don't know further into that right now.
Could I have the question again?
Are you going to vote to override the veto on the repeal of the death penalty?
Do you want the death penalty or not?
No, I'm against that. I have that on the line.
So you'll be voting to override the governor's veto?
No.
Are you for maintaining the death penalty in the state?
Yes, because it's the only thing we need to do.
Okay. And just so we're clear, and I actually talked to the governor earlier today about this. He would appreciate everybody's support in sustaining all of his vetoes. So just to be clear, when we have these questions, the form of the question will be, notwithstanding the governor's veto, should such and such a law or such and such a bill become law? So the correct vote, if you wish to sustain the governor's veto, is no. And if you want to override the governor's veto, then you would press the green button to vote yes. But if you are in favor of keeping the death penalty on the books, you will vote no.
Then I vote no.
Okay.
Absolutely.
I'm going to vote to keep the death penalty on the books.
Okay. And the next question is relative to House Bill 143. This allows the would expand the conditions that allows the parole board to impose a recommittal period of less than 90 days for a parolee who violates his or her parole if they successfully complete a residential substance abuse treatment program deemed acceptable by the board. The governor vetoed this bill, and he said in part in his veto message, "Well, based on good intentions, this bill will have concerning consequences. It does not distinguish between individuals who have committed a crime related to substance abuse and those who have committed an unrelated crime. The bill also does not require the parole board to determine that a shorter recommittal period is necessary to assist a prisoner with their recovery efforts." So the governor vetoed that law. Would you vote to support that veto or to override it? And we're starting with Joseph.
I'd sustain the veto.
Thank you.
If I understand it correctly, I'd sustain that veto.
Okay.
You know, I'll try not to do this on all of them, but to be honest, you know, this is something that takes a lot of research. Willing to put in the time, and I'd be right there with you guys if I was in the House of Representatives. But I'm not. I'd have to look into this for a number of hours and formulate a decision. Thank you.
I have to say I'm undecided because I've been whipping this all day. That's one of the things I've been whipping.
So you're prepared at least.
So,
no issue.
So it's a toss up between yes and no.
I will maintain the veto.
And Charlie? House Bill 143 on the
floor. Yes, I would maintain the veto. Vote the whole time.
The next bill that we'll be voting on for veto override is a bill that would begin licensing requirements for autonomous vehicle testing and establish an automated and connected vehicle testing deployment commission. The governor vetoed this piece of legislation because he says it fails to address level 3 and level 4 technology, which are equivalent to those being tested in a fatal Arizona accident this past March. This bill would allow for testing of any technology below level 5 without testers having to obtain a license or even notify the state, a lack of oversight which is not acceptable here in New Hampshire. So will you sustain the governor's veto or vote to override on this autonomous vehicle or licensing bill? Beginning with Julius.
Really?
And you know, let me just say that, you know, for the benefit of the people seeking office for the first time, in fairness to you, us who are currently serving in office, we're more familiar with these things. We've already voted on them, obviously, if it's passed the House and Senate and gone to the governor. So feel free to respond, as Joel has done a couple times, if, in fairness, if you're not fully familiar with it, that's a reasonable.
Yeah, I'm gonna go with that one.
Okay, all right.
I'll make it short and sweet. Look, from what you're saying, from the governor's position, it might sound reasonable that when more work needs done there, maybe it can come back. But I don't know. I have spent hours and hours reviewing it, which is exactly what I would do if I was in the House. So.
Well, let me warn you, if you get elected, you're not going to be able to spend hours and hours on every bill. You have over 1,000 bills filed every year, so you're going to have to do a quick study on these.
You're not going to be a person who reads every bill, eh? You'll sign it.
Yes, I am. How can you vote on something if you have it even?
Very simple. You learn the process. You can't read every bill until you die. You got to.
Okay. Is everybody answered this one?
No.
Mary's next one.
Mary, I'm sorry.
Sustained veto.
Okay.
Sustained veto.
Not sustained veto on that.
Okay, excellent.
I've actually driven some of those cars and I have a sustained veto and hope some more robust legislation.
House Bill 1763 proposed to increase the threshold required for governor and council to approve expenditures from the dam maintenance fund. The governor vetoed this because he said New Hampshire has a proud tradition of careful fiscal management and counseled against reducing popularly elected officials' oversight of expenditures on taxpayer dollars, absent compelling justification. Just to make it clear, there's the current threshold for disbursements from the dam maintenance fund is $75,000 without approval of governor and council. The bill that this relates to sought to raise that, to double it, to $150,000. So the funds from that, the dam maintenance fund, could be expended without approval of governor and council. So the governor vetoed the legislation because he felt it was more prudent for the governor and council to maintain that fiscal oversight that they currently have without raising the level of money that can be spent without their approval. So would you vote to sustain or override that veto?
Sustain.
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 And I'm not sure. Possibly override, just to reduce government oversight and reduce a little like waste of time by government officials. But I'm not sure.
Okay. Vote to sustain. Yeah, I'm not going to answer the question without more information. Okay. We have two more veto overrides, and that'll be it before closing statements. Senate Bill 365 creates, relates to renewable generation. Specifically biomass electric generation facilities. The governor vetoed this particular bill because he said it creates another immense subsidy for New Hampshire's six independent biomass plants. It would cost New Hampshire taxpayers approximately $25 million a year over the next 3 years, on top of the subsidy for these plants that already became law that was passed last year. So we can vote to sustain this veto or to override it, and beginning with Walter.
I didn't agree with the figures, and I'm going to vote to override the veto.
Okay. I'm overriding the veto.
I'm not sure. I'd probably sustain the veto based on cost, but I'm a big, large fan because when I've read it, it actually costs a lot of extra jobs.
I go sustain.
Surprise, I am actually familiar with this, and I would sustain the veto.
Override the veto.
Okay. The last question, veto overrides, relates to net energy metering limits for customer generators. House Bill 446, which the governor vetoed because he said it would cost ratepayers at least $5 to $10 million annually and is a handout to large scale energy developers. He says these immense projects should use incentives already available and to compete on their own merits. The businesses and working families of our state should not have to provide additional unjust taxation through higher electric bills. So will you vote to sustain or to override this veto?
Charlie. The
6-3-4-4-6. But I swear it's right here from me right now, so I'm very passionate about this.
So just give us the sustainable override.
I would vote to override his veto, and I sincerely hope that happens, and I think that that's going to lower.
All right, that's all we need to know.
Many businesses.
Mary.
Sustain.
Override.
Okay, so we definitely ferreted out some differences among the candidates, and that is it for the all of the questions, and we're going to move now to closing statements, in which each candidate will have 60 seconds for the timekeeper in order to give any final thoughts. And we're beginning with Joseph.
Right? Yeah. Thank you for having us here today. My basic issue with government is name growth, don't fix it. I'm a big fan of maintaining that taxes remain low. I'm adamantly against income tax or sales tax in New Hampshire. I'm also my team professional. I'm a large fan of tech industries, hoping to improve the New Hampshire to increase tech. Otherwise, I just hope to, if I get elected, to do the best I can to represent the other people in New Hampshire. All right,
Michael, thank you guys for having this forum. And I'm going to let the folks know that I'm all about free markets and low taxes. Freer markets, create a more prosperous society, and that is factual. No matter what the socialists tell you on the other side, and there's socialist creep happening in our government and in New Hampshire as well. Not as much as the rest of the country, but it's happening. And it doesn't work lately. My family has experience with it. Thank you.
Thank you. So I'll echo my colleagues here in the forum and thanking everybody who's putting this on. Representative Bates, Mr. Iron, Grant Brock, et cetera, everyone who showed up tonight, thank you. So I've been planning on running for state representative for a while. Wanted to serve Windham for two terms as selectman first. I feel that the time is right for me and my family and professionally, and I'm able to fully commit myself to this responsibility. So I signed up as a candidate on the first day, and I've spent the past 2 months knocking on doors at the transfer station. I'll be there tomorrow and at community events around town, meeting as many with my neighbors as possible to broaden my perspective on the issues that matter to them. So I look forward to collaborating, hopefully, with some of our currently serving representatives and many others on both sides of the aisle at the State House. I'm a strong conservative, which hopefully you heard here tonight, and I'm committed to fairly representing all Windham residents. So I sincerely appreciate your consideration for 1 of your 4 votes next Tuesday. And I know I'm over my time, but even though voting is at the high school next Tuesday from 7 a.m. to 8 p.m. at Windham, there is a September 11th remembrance ceremony at 8:30 a.m. at the fire station. So if you're able to, please stop by.
Thank you. Good evening. My name is Mary E. Griffin. I am seeking re-election as state representative for the town of Windham. In the past, I served on many town boards. Presently, I serve on the cable board and also host of Windham Watch, the television show. Presently, in Concord, I serve on the Ways and Means Committee with the title of Committee Whip. Previously, I served on the Municipal and County Government Committee for 6 years. I have also held leadership positions of Assistant Republican Whip and Deputy Majority Whip. I am also recorded with 100% attendance. I sincerely ask for your vote in the upcoming election, and thank you very much.
Welcome. Again, I'd like to thank David and Ken for the great job they did here, getting all the information together and doing this for the town of Windham. You're to be commended. And I'd like to also thank all the Windhamites, those at home and those in the audience for participating in the political process, too many P's. And I would also like to warmly thank the Windhamites for the opportunity of serving in the New Hampshire legislature as a state representative. It has been an enlightening, exciting, and humbling experience. Most know that I have been a Windham resident for the past 30 odd years, along with my wife Mimi and my daughter Casey. I am a United States Marine Corps veteran, American Legion member, and have a Bachelor of Science in Business Administration. I have served the past 10 years on the Public Works and Highways Committee in New Hampshire. Also, currently, I'm the Vice Chairman of the Rockingham Delegation Executive Committee, and Mary is also a Vice Chairman on that. It's another job that a lot of us do reveals that I do not violate your trust. However, I am considerate and fair to other views. Civility is still an asset that we have in New Hampshire House.
Wrap it up, Walter.
Freedom is not free, neither is education or health insurance. Somebody always has to pay the bill. Our patriotism and hard work are the keys to America and the state of New Hampshire for us to proudly call both of them home. I humbly ask for your consideration to vote on election day.
Thank you. So, that's your
Charlie. Thank you, Representative Sates.
I'm sorry, Charlie, I just cut you off.
Well, that's all right, and we keep moving here. But thank you again, Mr. Iger and Representative Sates, for putting this on, and for the members of Windham's voting cadre to be here tonight to be a part of this. I'm asking for your support to continue the work at the State House. I've been involved in the town of Windham since day one in making issues collaboratively come together. In the town as a past selectman, I was also the president of the baseball softball league for 10 years and was a key component of building Griffin Park and doing the town center across the street and in having leadership with vision by working collaboratively with our fellow citizens. This is what I learned in Windham to bring to the State House for the last 16 years. And I've handled issues dealing with developmental disabilities, elderly services, and also the protection of our quality of life, where I now serve as chair of the Seacoast Cancer Cluster Commission investigation, and which has an effect on our town as well. So I'd like to continue that effort and to be an aggressive advocate with manners on behalf of you, the citizens of Windham, and I'm one that you can count on every single day. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much. So I'd like to reiterate how we started tonight by thanking the candidates for coming. Thank you to the audience who came to participate and hear what these candidates had to say, how they will represent us. And also thank you to folks from Windham Cable TV, Kelly and Barbara and Wally, and the folks from the Rock. We've got Skip and we've got Mike for covering the event. It's very important. This is how a constitutional republic is supposed to work, so people can cast an informed vote. And with that, I'd like to remind people to go out and cast that vote on Tuesday. Don't let this opportunity pass you by. It's your sacred right and duty to do so. So thank you everybody for this evening. Dave, do you want to say anything else?
Yes, I also want to thank all the candidates for participating and particularly for observing our time constraints. It allowed us to cover a lot of territory and a lot of issues, and I think that the voters will be very appreciative of having that broad perspective of what your views and values are on a very wide variety of topics. Also want to thank the people who came to hear this forum in person, as well as all of those watching at home by TV and those who will see it in the upcoming days as it's rebroadcast. And finally, the one last thing I want to say is just thank you to all the residents of Windham who has given me the privilege of serving you in the past four terms as a state representative in the legislature. And it's been an honor to represent you. And I would echo the encouragement that you've heard here that everybody show up next Tuesday and play your part in casting your vote. The polls will be open at the Windham High School from 7 in the morning to 8 p.m. And that concludes our program for tonight.
Well, before we do that, Dave, I just want to, I've said to you hundreds of